The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
Live from Toronto to the world.
Josh!
This is Josh Holiday Live. Talk that rocks.
The public needs to be informed.
Josh might surprise us.
Got an opinion? Dial 647-6-YO-JOSH.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Josh Holiday Live starts now.
Yes, live Friday afternoon, March the 24th. Busy as all get out, as someone my age should not be saying. That phrase should not be in my vernacular, but I'm trying to bring these things back. As I said, busy show today. The Statue of David apparently is pornographic. We're going to talk about dating shows, including Love is Blind, women who are obsessed with guys with accents, tattoos, people getting tattoos of their pets. We'll get a little bit into the homophobia that's reared its ugly head in the NHL. Talk about how the Toronto Maple Leafs, I think, has the worst goal song in the entire league, though it ranked only 15 on a recent survey. Happiest countries, topless maids, Japanese or Chinese kissing devices. It's all coming up on this very show. You can call us 6476-YO-JOSH. Brett's here. Good day, sir.
Good afternoon,
to you,
Canada.
Woo. This one, I bring it up only briefly because I was so shocked to see it. But a lady in Florida, of course, a superintendent of a school there had to either resign or be fired because a parent complained about the Statue of David and it being shown in class and described it as pornographic. Now,
I mean, what do you want, dude? The human body's controversial. You're behind the times.
It's not like it's a guy, an ancient guy who has
a naked man,
but a very small, very small and flaccid ween. I would understand if he was in some kind of like sexual position or he had
he's just standing there.
He's just kind of standing there. And I guess this is what happens when you give the power to parents. You get the lowest common denominators deciding that history and culture is
important. Here you go. You elite Toronto overnight Canadian.
Let me have a sip of my latte.
You're a vain, cosmopolitan man of the world. You talk it down to the hardworking Americans of the state of Florida.
There's hardworking, common sense Americans. There's intelligent, hardworking Floridians.
People in this country right now, we're having a moment.
Yeah,
we're really not able to process that we have bodies, and they're okay to talk about.
But it's particularly exacerbated. Florida seems to be like the bellwether of the worst things. In the States.
Florida is getting there. I mean, this is kind of a Florida moment as well in this moment in history.
Yeah,
they're leading the way in so many
craziness.
Respects.
Yeah. It's
doing what they do. They do them. They do Florida.
Now, you're a guy, I'm a guy, you have a wife. Does she or as a couple, do you watch any kind of dating reality shows on television?
Never.
Ever?
She has watched The Bachelor like when it was brand new, like 20, okay, maybe 2011-ish, 2010. Oh, no, it was because The Bachelor was from kind of around where we live, so I think that was the only draw. But no, they're not for me.
Local man. Maybe it's because
I never watched one episode of any of them.
Maybe it's because you're coupled up and you have actual life things to do. I watch a lot of them because I don't know. I just am fascinated by kind of the the social experiments, as it were. I'm just sort of fascinated by human behavior and interaction, even though so much of it is scripted and fictionalized and amped up.
You're watching a construct social experiment of people going through the motions of courting, but they're not.
Yeah, you have to.
How often do you see a genuine intimacy develop between people?
No, it's not. It's not often.
Could be shared because there's television cameras involved and microphones.
Yeah, when the producers are always ginning things up, otherwise it would be very boring.
They're unwatchable to me for that reason because they're just charades.
I'm willing to suspend not my disbelief, but just to kind of put that aside and not really think about it too much when I'm watching. One of the most popular of these dating shows on Netflix, which has jumped into the dating shows pretty heavily, is Love is Blind. And the concept of that is they put about 15 dudes and about 15 ladies in two separate kind of living areas. And then during the day, they each come in adjoining compartments and they talk through kind of a wall without seeing each other. And they have these conversations. And at the end of it, they decide, hey, I want to get engaged with this person. We had such a great connection.
How long did they talk to each other when they can't see?
Well, it's done over like a period of time, like a week or so. And they,
I'm saying each conversation is what, an hour? How long do they talk in here?
They don't go into like the very specific details, but I guess then people start narrowing it down. Like, I really like talking to her. I'm going to go talk to her again. And it really is a very fast process for what's actually happening, where it's like engagement type stuff. So, but it is fun to watch when they finally like meet face to face. Sometimes you can see a hint of disappointment.
Sure.
Although the show, it's all like pretty decent looking people. It's not like they get a lot of schlubs in there. Which I think would make for a more interesting experiment. If love was truly blind, you would have like ordinary people and see whether or not love truly is blind. But in this case,
well, they managed at least to find enough people that enjoyed talking to each other for that period of time and could get a connection going, then want to be like, hey, what's up with this person?
Well, and then once they're out in the world, like once they meet each other, then they're kind of, they sometimes socialize as a group and stuff. And you see guys who are talking to certain girls don't realize, oh, they were actually pretty hot. I'm now more attracted to this girl who I was talking to than the other one. So, yeah, I don't know. I like all the novelty shows. There was dating
that
in the...
That sounds better than the average dating, like The Bachelor.
Yeah,
you have the wrinkle of people connecting in a more genuine way, which is unusual. I've never heard of such a thing.
There was another one I always like sort of the high concept ones. There was the Joe Millionaire where all these women thought that they were dating a millionaire and he was just some construction worker.
I think the thing is that the individual at the center of this for me is never compelling, and so their adventure going, like, what are they doing? Consuming the women of this particular studio lot, you know, this corporate.
Well, that's the thing with The Bachelor. It's like all of these people, as soon as they see this bachelor, are ready to like give their complete love and life to this one
guy. I mean, but I think that that's all still just posturing.
Yeah, but it is.
They never work out, but it's like, I will be whatever, you know, like, but that happens on both sides of the, whichever gender they throw it into the mix, both people are fawning after the other.
Yeah. Well, I think with The Love is Blind, at least it's not one central protagonist.
More compelling, but I still don't want to watch it.
Yeah. The other one I remember watching is Dating in the Dark, which was, they would, you know, people would meet up in a dark room, and then I don't know how it happened, if there was like some reward or whatever, where they would see like a 1 second flash of light where they could see the person for a second, or they were revealed. Conveyor of love. There was a conveyor belt where people could select people coming along the conveyor belt, and then sometimes like they would
meat,
see
like meat in a factory. My God,
it is essentially
you're modify everything, and then you're gonna here they are here the Royal London Assembly line of hot ladies for you, sir. Point and click, whatever. I hate it.
I do like, and this one I'm curious that of you're aware of. There's a dating show hosted by I think Dallas radio personality Chris Jagger.
That is right. I remember that.
I can't remember the name of it, but basically,
what was that called?
They brought couples on who are kind of like deciding whether or not to break up, and they would send each of them on dates with people who they deem more compatible. And then they would decide to stay together and not stay together.
It's known as change of heart.
Change of heart. I love that show. I think because of the psychology of seeing right in front of your eyes, like the jealousy and the actual guys being dumped live. Maybe I'm sick a little bit in enjoying watching that happen in real time.
You know, that's one of those that's, you know, that's not quite as successful as you know, Cheaters, which is antithesis.
Cheaters is Joey Greco getting stabbed.
These are Dallas-based syndicated television series. Cheaters far more successful than Change of Heart.
I didn't know Cheaters was Texas-based.
Yeah, that is a Dallas-based show. I have comedian friends who were on Cheaters as a fake scenario.
Oh, nice. Yeah. I remember when Joey Greco got stabbed, and that was sort of, I think that was like the peak,
you know,
Cheaters.
Joey Greco, that's so funny. I actually, you know, I do have a take on him. He had a great news presenter's aura and brought this to you like it was some real serious late breaking events that you needed to know about.
Well, and the phony sincerity of like, we're really trying to help this person. We really,
he kind of had a little bit of a Mike Wallace character about him where he would be confrontational with people.
Yeah.
I never thought about that. Joey Greco. He has the Mike Wallace vibe.
Mike Wallace of dating shows. Yeah. Cheaters is, do you remember Studs? You remember that show was popular for a period of time? That one basically glorified like douchebag guys. They would come on and date a couple of ladies, and it was just trash. Yeah,
why wouldn't it?
No. So I don't know. I get addicted to this. Another one that I like because it plays on all the jealousies is the Temptation Island, where they couple. It's sort of like an exotic version of Change of Heart.
Some married people where it's together.
Well, it's people who are on the verge of getting married. They've been in couples for a long time, and they're like, I don't know, it's do or die time, and so they hook them up with people who tempt them.
You know, we're now commenting on a terrible genre, but let's move forward.
I love it.
With whatever's next.
Anyway, I haven't watched it, but there's the new Love is Blind is debuting this week, so I'll let you know.
Okay, well, go consume it. Go binge else's affair.
As I've mentioned in the past, I'm a single dude reluctantly on dating apps. And one thing I see quite frequently is, I'm a sucker for a guy with an, we were talking about this last week, talking about just accents in general, your British, Irish, and there's people who will post on their profiles, I'm a real sucker for someone with a British accent or an Irish or an accent. And I feel kind of like your accent is not a personality. I've always theorized that you could be a kind of a like a real kind of dork or a real like loser in your home country. Say you're an Englishman who's a real kind of loser at home, and you come to Canada and you meet a lady, and because you have that British accent, all of a sudden you're like a high status guy. The ladies love you. So I would recommend to any Briton or Australian or Irish guy that if you're not doing so well over in your own country, why not come to Canada?
Why not? Your accent can be a new wrinkle in your life.
Yeah, it's
in a way it wasn't before.
Well, and the same thing, you see that sometimes on dating sites too, where women are like, oh, I love guys with tattoos. A tattoo isn't a personality either. It's like
it's
something,
a signifier of you know,
of what,
however you want to express yourself. You know, it's a signifier of people have all kinds of. I don't know. I mean, I feel like that's like, you know, A tattoo is an outward expression of something about the personality of the person.
But you might as well put in your profile, I'm a fan of guys who wear graphic tees. Because it's just, it's the same thing. It's like a t-shirt with a designer. Yeah.
The graphic tee fan is out there.
but
they're not gonna post about it.
It just feels so surface because, like, sure. Tattoos are such a, there's such a wide range of them. And I have a brother who has on his butt one of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles saying cowabunga. So, ladies, he's like in his 30s, late 30s. He's married. Yeah.
Right.
So, but it wasn't, he didn't get it recently.
Right, of course. No, he was early, you know, so he's a millennial. He was coming of age as the Ninja Turtles were, like, peaking again.
Yeah, and he got it to be goofy, I guess. And
I was always, fortunately, always too old for the Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
I was never a fan.
It didn't really do much for me.
But I can see people of a certain age going, like, let's get a cowabunga tattoo. That's how powerful media is. It can make you put a Ninja Turtle with cowabunga.
You don't have any tattoos, do you?
No,
me neither. I've never.
I was never ready to commit to. I will think this is appealing for the rest of my life. I doubt it.
That's the same. I think you know. This going back to the graphic tee analogy. I think, are there any T-shirts with graphics on it that I've worn for like 20 years? Or not got tired of, and there's none that I think, oh, I wish I was still wearing that.
I mean, if I have a band T-shirt of music I like, that graphic will stay. But otherwise, I'm a blank slate. It's all just colors. I like no logos.
Other than sports
affiliation, I'll show you that, but that's it.
Yeah. I worked with a guy once who he was going to get a tattoo of a lyric from a song, and he had it grammatically incorrect when he was kind of showing us the drawings. And unfortunately, people told him, oh, yeah, that's you better fix that. But
you wanted him to have a mistake.
Well, it would have been fun, like just funny because it was cheesy to begin with, having this, you know, this dopey musical lyric.
But see, there's a dating app that says that people like that,
I guess. So
he's gained entry into that. Part of the human experience.
Well, I'm sure he's been more successful than I have. The only tattoo wise, and I mentioned this before, the only thing I think I would get is just like somewhere in my body, the number 7, because it's my hockey number. It's lucky number, but I'm not like driven to do it. But a lot of people get tattoos of their pet. They did a study of 2,000 cat and dog owners. 25% would consider getting a tattoo of their current pet, and 25% already planning to get it, and 16% already have it. I don't like the idea of getting portraits of people or pets because it's rare. Like, there's so many examples of bad tattoos online where it just looks like a bad version of the pet.
You got to find a person who can draw your pet and do it well.
And then, you know, your skin isn't always going to look the same way. So,
there's too many variables for me.
Yeah.
Paint me a picture.
Yeah, maybe just...
I'll hang it on the wall. I plan to have more pets than my body will be able to accommodate graphic representations of a menagerie.
Well, yeah, get just a text version of your pet's name if you're that excited about it.
Yeah, just the names. Yeah. No, I like, you know, paint me a picture. I'll look at it.
Yeah. What if you got a tattoo of your dog and then your dog caught some kind of like distemper and killed your child,
and
then what
your life, you got the shoulder tattoo of your dog and you got to look in a mirror to see it.
Other stuff, 36% of, and I'm embarrassed to admit this, 36% of pet owners have a dedicated social media account for their pet. I do have an Instagram that my dog Boise the Beagle, but I only just put it there as a repository for pictures, and because you know, a certain amount of friends look at it for updates. I don't like put a ton of hashtags and like promote it like crazy. Maybe like once or twice a month, I'll put a new picture up there. 60% of pet owners believe their cat or dog has what it takes to become a viral sensation.
because they do.
Yeah, all of them.
Because if you got the camera out at the right moment, you get a viral dog.
This one, I don't know about you. Do you have conversations with your pet when no one else is around?
Certainly.
55% of people do that.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you? You got to tell them what's going on in the house. Tell them to get down. Tell them no.
Yeah.
That works.
But you just chat. I find one of the reasons I have a dog is because I live alone, and I would find there would some days would go by where the only words I would say was, you know, maybe when I was in the coffee shop ordering a coffee. So I'd speak actually speak once in a whole day just because it was, you know, right. you're kind of isolated.
I mean, you got a pandemic event happening. If you got a pet on hand to talk to, you're better off.
Yeah. And he listens, and
I had a moment with the dog. I got a cat that likes the dog that was a kitten when the dog was around. And so the cat is sweet to the dog and lays over on it and rubs on it. It's, you know, rubs his face on the dog's face. And then at one point I said, you know, he had stopped, and I told him to give the dog more cuddles. And indeed he did.
Look at that. I'll take it.
I've whispered to the cat. Communicated intention. Cat received the message. Acted on my will. I'm all in.
You should have had it. If you had a camera, you could have been a viral sensation.
I know. I've recorded that. Yeah, I got that one.
Oh, okay.
I'll post it. Never.
All right. The Leafs goal song is terrible. We'll talk about that in just a sec.
You all know that thing you use to send text? It works for actual mouth talking.
Josh stuff.
Get in on the conversation. Punch 647-6-YO-JOSH to be heard. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday Live.
Yes, live. A song about the Toronto Maple Leafs. 50 mission cap. Not the goal song for when the Toronto Maple Leafs score a goal. The Leafs for the last couple of years have been using a song that makes zero sense. It's a Hall & Oates song that they use as their goal song. I'll give you here. This is what the goal song for the Toronto Maple Leafs sounds like after they score a goal. Yeah. So I don't know. I don't like. I used to theorize that soft hockey team, because the Leafs were very soft for the last 4 or 5 years. They've been a very unphysical, soft team. And I thought, well, soft rock, soft team. Now they've gotten a little bit more of an aggressive roster. And I don't know. I feel like that's just such a weird song to have. And no one really has been able to explain from the organization, like, who specifically chose it. There's a lot of speculation that it's like some executive or someone high up in the organization decided it, and that's why it's lasted so long.
I was really wanting to come in and play devil's advocate when I saw the topic, but I can't argue with that. That is a milquetoast choice.
Yeah, you kind of want the live crowd to get hyped
probably
up.
Harder Hall & Oates songs that would be at least rock and roll.
Yeah, it's you notice it in the arena, like. They had a St. Patrick's Day game here, and that's the one time they didn't play this song. They played some Irish kind of upbeat song, and you could tell the crowd got that much more excited. It's hard to get excited when you hear this, like, dopey boop, 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 boop. The interesting thing is, and I was kind of upset a little bit by this, the Athletic, a sports news website, what's that? What do you call it? A zine?
It's a web zine, I would say. You know, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. It's like a sports magazine online. A zine. They did a survey of their readers, and over 2,000 people replied. And they got you to rank from 1 to 10 each of the goal songs for the every team around the NHL. And I was really, really surprised, because it just came out today, that the Leafs were at number 15. So only, like, basically right dead in the middle average of all the songs in the league. I was sure that it was going to be the very last place song.
I had to look up the Dallas Stars goal song, fight song.
Where is the Dallas Stars? I'm going to look on this list here. I think Dallas Stars, I'm looking. Dallas Stars, that one I liked. It's number 10. It's Puck Off by Pantera. So it's actually like a song by Pantera that was written specifically for the Dallas Stars.
Yeah, that sounds fine.
That was like when I did the voting, that was near the top of my list because I thought that's fantastic.
Yeah, there's a lot of them. That's a North Texas staple, Pantera.
I was surprised. The Boston one kind of surprised me because I thought they used a Dropkick Murphy song for some reason all along. I thought it was like Shipping Out to Boston or whatever. But this is the song they use. Let me just get to the middle of it. Like the most generic jock jam song of all time.
I did not hear that. So
oh, you didn't? Oh, no. Maybe because I'm playing over the computers like that. It's basically your basic jock jam, Zombie Nation, Kerncraft 4000 or whatever. So I'm not a fan of the Leafs goal song, and I was really hoping that it would finish last, so at least there would maybe be some incentive in the front office to change it. Maybe if they fail out again in the playoffs this year, they will change not just the roster, but the goal
song.
How
long have Hall & Oates been involved with the Leafs?
I think ever since, I would guess maybe the last 5 years.
That's a very near term. This is a storied franchise, don't they?
No, it's not it's not a long term thing for sure. I don't remember what it was before that, or if it was a thing. Yeah,
that's why they had to get something.
But I think it's time to start shopping for a new one. There's so many options, and Toronto is such a great music city that so many bands have come through, and it's ridiculous that you have this cheese ball song. While we're on the topic of the NHL, this is sad mostly. Lately, there's been a lot of controversy over NHL teams having Pride Nights. Now, the main controversy is not them having the Pride Nights to begin with. It's during warm-ups, players are supposed to be wearing these Pride hockey jerseys, so kind of a pridified version of the team jersey, and then they auction them off for charity. And so what happened a while ago, I think in Philadelphia, there was a Russian player, Ivan Provorov, who he decided he wasn't going to wear it. And that was the initial controversy. And then last week, it's reared its ugly head again. There was a goalie, James Reimer, who used to play for the Toronto Maple Leafs and had long been described as the nicest guy in the NHL. And by all accounts, like a sweet guy, but maybe a little misguided. So he was the only guy in the San Jose Pride Night game who didn't wear the jersey. And he put out a statement saying, oh, you know, it goes against my Christian beliefs. You know, I'm all for inclusion and everything, but I just can't because it's against my Christian beliefs. And then later this week, two of the Stahl brothers in Florida, the Florida Panthers, they didn't come out for the warm-up because they didn't want to wear the jerseys because they're Christians, good Christians, and they can't go along with that. And then the funny thing that emerged is one of the Stahl brothers, they dug up from not that long ago, a few years ago, he was playing for the Montreal Canadiens, and they showed him coming out on the ice wearing a Pride jersey for a Montreal Canadiens game. So
he had no problem with
it. No problem before.
At that point, it's fine. It's fine.
I just get frustrated with the idea that you're using Christianity as an excuse. Like I think it's
just, this is a moment. This is now there's this like political moment. It's kind of this moment in history where, oh, what? there's a new consciousness that's sitting there going like, wait, we could make an issue out of this.
Yeah, it feels, and it really feels.
When he accepted it, just as a matter of course in the past.
Yeah, well, and the other thing too is, I mean, it feels like a just looking at where Christianity is.
There's a political backlash that's underway because America has become a dysfunctional democracy. And there's, I could go on for another 20 minutes. But
oh, I know.
To hear about that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's just, it just seems like Christianity is being used as a cudgel, as a weapon against progress.
It's like, I mean, if you want to put it in those terms, I mean, I'm not going to sit there and disagree with that exactly.
But okay.
But it's like, but I mean, religion holds fast to an older ancient conception of things, and
yeah,
but it's you know, amongst those, that conception is, hey, look, you're supposed to love each other, and then everybody still kind of has a tentative agreement about that. But yet, like, when there's a moment to have a political dimension appear, it's like, well, let me get into the politics of it too, because I can be a force for progress that he thinks is progress. I don't even know.
Well, it's very selective. It's like, okay, so you're not gonna, because of your Christian beliefs, you're not gonna wear this pride jersey. Does it also mean that you're not gonna work on the Sabbath? You're not gonna play any games on a Sunday? like there's so many and tattoos. You're not supposed to have tattoos in the Bible. Like.
Yeah. I mean, right. Yeah. I mean, but people have different concerns at different moments in history, right? Like, you know, the abolition movement was clear-sighted and the rest of Christianity wasn't, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, we're in this moment of like mass consciousness where people are trying to react to global trends and it's activating, you know, irritations in people that they never even knew they had.
Yeah.
Well, but they got to work it out. I mean, I think things are getting better. And the fact is that this is news is like, and it's irritating to us.
It is. Well, it is.
I think that's true for most people.
Yeah. I think the other thing too, is that it's not wearing this jersey is not an endorsement of like, I think everyone should be, it's basically just saying, hey,
yeah, I mean, they think it's an endorsement. I mean,
I support
even,
all
just
people
have their perspective and they want to now have a new dimension of comment, right?
Yeah, but it's certainly like on the comment boards, it makes you realize like how far we have to go to get acceptance. It's just like brought the bigots out of the woodwork in a major way.
You know, let me put it to you like this: there's a lot of projection on the political right.
Yeah, this is true. All right. Well, is Canada one of the happiest countries? Is the U.S. one of the happiest countries in the world? A recent thing came out ranking countries by happiness, and we'll let you know if you made the top 10 in just a sec.
Something bugging you? Fire! Need a vent?
Where the f*** is Josh?
This is your unfiltered megaphone.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Dial 647-6-YO-JOSH now to be heard. Talk that rocks. Rocks. Josh Holiday, live.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like happiness.
Apparently, Monday is International Day of Happiness. And the UN's World Happiness Report 2023 was unveiled. And neither of our countries, you in the U.S., me in Canada, neither made the top 10. Canada was number 13. The U.S. was number 15. Unhappy people. There certainly is, if you look at who's in the top 10, what countries are in the top 10, your Switzerland's, your Norway's, your Sweden's, your Netherlands, your Iceland's,
sure,
your Denmark's, your
right,
a lot of Nordic countries, but
yep,
a lot of social democracies where,
that's right,
yeah,
social safety net reduces the psychic burdens of living.
Exactly.
So people are happier. It's basic, you know, it's basic math at a certain level.
And here they're trying to I don't want to get too deep into it, but both here in Canada, they're trying to trying to like roll back all of those protections and move away from social democracy.
As I've become more learned about what Canada is actually like, I all the Americans who sit there and dream about, well, we'll just go to Canada if it gets real bad. I mean, they don't realize they're only moving up two spots on the happiness chart to go to Canada.
Although it's weird because I see a lot of other I don't know what it is, U.S. News and World Report that often puts out these kind of lists and all kinds of like places people would most like to live. It's always Canada, cities that Canada, like Canada's very popular, but I was actually surprised to see it at number 13. But
well, outside of, I mean, Vancouver, I feel like, you know, everybody wants to live there and that's why it's outrageous.
I a lot of people do because it's a beautiful city and mountains,
great weather.
I don't know. It's very rainy. Very rainy in Vancouver.
Got no problem with rain.
I don't like rain because my dog doesn't like rain. So by association, he doesn't like to go out in the rain. But the other thing I find about Vancouver as a city is it's very spread out, whereas Toronto is fairly condensed.
Sounds more appealing. Yeah, I've not been to Toronto, but I just know what's up with winter.
Winter sucks.
Yeah,
basically. So.
Not really my first choice.
This was interesting, something that came out of the pandemic. I guess not only were scientists and technically creative people coming up with vaccines and medicines and ways to help with the pandemic, a Chinese startup that was inspired by the lockdown has invented a long-distance kissing machine. It basically transmits users' kiss data collected through motion sensors hidden in silicone lips, which simultaneously move when replaying kisses received. I don't know if you saw it. I didn't send you a picture of this, but
no, you did not.
But it basically hooks on top of, like, it looks like it hooks on top of an iPhone. It is basically like these fleshy lips.
So your phone, you attach lips to the phone.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then you make out and with your phone.
You plug it in your phone.
We're already doing it.
Yeah. It's called Mua, MUA, sure. And it's named after the sound you make when blowing a kiss. Mua.
Yeah, so that's universal. You don't need translation for that.
It captures and replays sound and warms up slightly during kissing. That makes the experience more authentic. Can
you hear the servos of the motors moving?
You have to oil it up. There's a lot of possibilities with a pair of moving rubber lips.
It's going to have to play music or something to cover up the sound of the motors.
And you can download kissing data submitted by random people, too. So there's a database of people's...
Now that's interesting. You could rando kiss.
The inventor said, quote, "I was in a relationship back then, but I couldn't meet my girlfriend due to lockdowns." He was a student at university. It came out not too long ago, and it was priced at about $38. And they've received about 20,000 orders in the first 2 weeks. Among the top complaints was its lack of tongue. So it's basically just lips.
Yeah, I knew that was going to have to be the case.
Yeah, French.
They were not going to be able to automate everything. It was just going to be a moi.
Yeah.
Quick little kiss.
Yeah.
That's all you can get. You'll run the battery down if you hang out with it too long.
Yeah. And
I believe, though, that, you know, like, what if this thing gets hacked and, you know, bites down or something?
Yeah.
Like, we can't.
I guess if it had teeth, that would be like issue.
When we are really brought down, human beings, you know, as physical things, it's going to be through the sex robots. That's all I'm saying.
Well, and I don't think I ever. We mentioned
get us first.
We mentioned the word dildonics on this show in the past.
I don't believe I
don't know if,
that.
Yeah, I don't know if so basically dildonics is where you create things that feel lifelike that are robotic, but it's so essentially you could have sex with someone remotely. You would put your, sure. you would put your, if you're a guy, you would put your wiener in
yeah,
this.
You just got, yeah, yeah. You just got body parts. You got synthetic body parts of people laying around. You're like, let me download.
Yeah.
You know,
but then like you're
15,306 into this one. Yeah.
But then your wiener's the whatever your wiener's doing in that synthetic thing, the synthetic yeah. lady just, part.
I gotcha. Yeah.
The lady on the other end of the
she's
interaction, like in another yeah. place, she's right. gonna feel exactly what your
she
ween
has
is
the
doing.
Dildonic. Yeah. Right.
So that's,
I hear you.
That's dildonic. So I feel like the kissing machine is really
remote
just
is what we're trying to.
Yeah.
That's what we need. Apparently, is we need electronic, you know, to interference or intervention really in the long distance relationship.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah. But it's going to be expensive, so just buy yourself a plane ticket.
Well, this is only $38. You can get a kiss.
Well, the kiss, yeah, but
that's why I'm telling you, man. Yeah. This just shows you the potential of the marketplace to bring forward these goods at a cost approachable price.
But any good kiss involves tongue, and if your kissing machine doesn't have a tongue,
you have to say that out loud. We already know that.
Yeah, no, I know, but I'm just saying, if the kissing machine doesn't have a tongue, then what? You know, it's useless.
You know, it's just a novelty at that point.
Yeah. You put it on your keychain or something. This is kind of this strikes me as kind of creepy. There's a lady who posted on socials that she's a topless maid. So essentially, she goes into houses.
It tells us the stories contained in the title.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, she goes in topless. She does have, for security reasons, a dude who hangs out in the car outside.
Well, yeah.
In case things go awry.
Yeah, too. Yeah, if things go awry.
But I don't understand the appeal of this at all. It's like such a, you're watching someone just, there's nothing sexual about cleaning, and it's just someone nude in your house.
And then they are getting relatively less clean as cleaner and materials of cleaning are in the atmosphere around them.
Well, the other thing is like, they're not going to do a good job because the main reason they're in there cleaning is just, you know, and getting the money is because you're topless.
I know. It's a topless show that a person then pays, you know, it's performative cleaning, I guess.
But I would just be I've never been a guy who's even enjoyed strip clubs. I get just more embarrassed I'll sit in a seat facing away from the stage just because I don't like, it's just so weird.
No, I don't. It's not for me.
You have some guys who go to script clubs and they're like, it's like they're hypnotized. They're just will stare like with this
right
stare and drool. Where I'm like, I just try and avoid like looking.
That's where they're at, man. Some people, that's where they're at, brother.
So, anyway, this lady, she says she makes over $2,000 a day to clean houses.
Yeah,
and that's not one like that's not one stop. Apparently, she.
I don't know why we should discount her house cleaning, like we suspected substandard house cleaning. Perhaps not.
She might be great. She makes $300 an hour and with tip on top. The first house she cleaned gave her $150 tip. I don't know how much she gives to the security dude who lurks outside.
Well, that's two jobs that have been created by this innovation in the economy.
But you think if you have a house of just a regular size, it's going to be at least for a cleaner who's Just say your average cleaner, nothing to do with topless. It's going to take at least 3 hours, at least if you're getting just
one person to do it.
Yeah,
yeah.
So that's like $1,000.
Too bad the guy can't help clean.
Yeah, well that
and
would
protect her at that distance, isn't that?
Oh,
the,
oh,
right
the security
distance?
Guy. Yeah, that would be funny. Like this big burly guy lurking around cleaning the toilet while she's
he's
in the
cleaning. Also, what's wrong with that, sir? Why can't you get involved in the work?
Yeah.
You know, workers of the world unite. Let's get busy, sir.
But I like
do your part.
How would the mechanics of this work though? If this lady's in your house, like, would you just go and like kind of follow her around and watch her as she
it's
cleans?
The opposite of the normal experience that when someone has their house cleaned, they usually try to get out of their way. This is now like moth to the flame. It's a terrible arrangement for the function we're attempting to accomplish.
Yeah, I just picture this like puppy dog like guy following her around, just watching.
Yeah. And that's I guess that's those genre of male that you've just identified, the puppy dog guy.
And what's
wants to hang out and see the naked lady dance around or whatever, and so he goes to the strip club or he has a topless maid show up at his house.
You're going to spend like over a grand to have a lady.
You're consuming this person visually, and you're paying for the right to do it.
Yeah,
but I don't know how I feel about that. I think there's an ethical problem there on some level, but I don't know, because this other person's being able to capture rent off of this guy's attention. So I guess that's what you should do. You know, I mean, it's hard to know.
Well, and then you would think after like 10 minutes of looking at this lady's boobs that you'd be like, okay, I got them memorized. That's it. Like,
10 minutes?
Like how you're going to know every detail. If you're looking at a woman's breasts for 10 minutes straight, you're going to know every detail.
You need 10 minutes to figure out what it looks like.
No, then, I'm just throwing it out there. Like I'm just saying 3 hours
10 seconds, you just like,
is overkill. All right. Yep. That's what they're
good.
Like.
Good. Go back to work. Yeah, thanks. I mean, I don't need it. What is this?
What is this?
It's sweeping the nation. It's a gaming sensation. And oh, it has the greatest prize.
What prize? Sure.
I don't know. It's absolutely useless. It's absolutely pointless. It's the game that we call bragging rights.
All right, a little bragging rights to wind the show down on. This particular quiz is a this or that type thing. I will name a phrase or a word, and you have to determine whether it is a bizarre disease or a figure skating move. Are you ready to play? Are the rules
a bizarre disease or a figure skating move?
Okay.
All right. Fun.
Here we go. Mm-hmm. Toe Wally.
I believe that is figure skating.
That is correct. Swizzle.
I also think that is skating.
String halt.
It sounds like skating.
String halt is a disease. I do not know anything about this disease. I just know it's a disease. Double stag.
Skating.
Yeah, I don't know what disease a double stag would be. Yeah, it's skating. Mazurka.
Mazurka sounds like a disease.
It's a figure skating move.
String halt is equine reflex hypertonia.
Oh, okay. See,
so
it's
these aren't just diseases of humans now.
Yeah, it's just a bizarre disease. Give me whatever. Okay. Jumping Frenchman of Maine.
Oh, that sounds like skating.
That's actually a disease. The jumping, maybe you can look that up while we continue. Jumping Frenchman of Maine. Half Lutz.
That sounds like skating. That is skating.
That is skating. Yeah, that's a pretty common one. Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, come on. Skating.
Another bizarre disease, apparently.
Oh, it's like, yeah, it's like a.
Yeah. Falling leaf.
Falling leaf syndrome. That's maybe. Let's go disease.
Oh, it's a figure skating thing. Falling leaf, apparently.
Started strong. Now I'm failing.
Well, it's. I mean, you're not expected to know a whole ton about figure skating or like really rare bizarre.
I mean, when I see it, you know, it is pretty sometimes when they're people are good at.
Yeah. Okay. Finally, walking corpse.
Walking corpse. Why would that be a skating move?
Unless it's like a Halloween show, but it's.
Well, if it's a disease, it's a real problem.
Yeah, yeah. It is a disease. Yes. So there you go, people. It's not just it's not just pop culture and jibber jabber. We also educate on bizarre diseases and skating moves.
Turn on the lights. Open the shades.
The show's over, but the conversation continues
on Twitter at Josh Holiday. On the web at joshholidaylive.com. And hear missed episodes on your favorite podcatcher. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday Live.